Anladım beni. You know what? Let's just get the show on.
Make up my mind.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And also a top of the morning to you. Welcome to Greendale People's Church, those who are gathered here in the chapel, those who are viewing at this moment from home, and those who will be viewing this service throughout the week. Welcome, and the Lord be with you this day and in every day. To some of you, I say welcome back because you were here yesterday for the service that we had for our brother, Russ Bickstrom. And it was a meaningful time for us to be together. And I was just thinking to myself, when I was younger, I could do a funeral on a Saturday, spend all the energy I had, and Sunday morning I'd wake up and I'd have a full tank. And now I don't. That's right, hold it. But I got to thinking, was I just too young and foolish to know that I was tired that Sunday morning years ago? Neither here nor there. What matters is not my degree of energy, but the power of the Lord, the Holy Spirit among us. And it is for that reason that we are gathered today. So welcome to Greendale People's Church. Usually when Annie is doing her pre-service music is when everyone talks. And when she stops playing, everybody suddenly grows silent. I always find that ironic. For the prelude, however, it's different. She plays music and we are all still and quiet so that our hearts are prepared to receive a word from God in the sacrament this day. So let's do that now. Let's prepare our hearts for worship with the prelude. Where we have heard your word, where we have experienced your spirit, where we have gathered with friends in mutual support and love. And so we are eager this day to receive those good things from you, which are from you, the good that is higher than all the good little things that we fret so much about. Bring your goodness among us this day, we pray, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand and sing number 50, Great is the Lord. Today comes from the 145th Psalm, verses 1 through 8, and Ginny Warden has that reading for us now.
Morning.
Morning.
Psalm 145, 1 through 8, a psalm of praise of David. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you. I exalt your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and the most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commands your work to another. Tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. Tell me of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we go to prayer, we remember those in our congregation who are going through some sort of event during this coming week. Our brother Dennis body shop to have some work done on his body, and we remember him in prayer. All the many others who have had long-standing difficulties, and those who are more episodic and have just arisen, we remember them in prayer. We also remember how good God is and how thankful we are for all that we receive. Let's pray. Lord, you've gathered us once again. Throughout the week, we go through circumstances. We encounter people and things. And we, after the fact, look back on what we have experienced, and we can say, well, that was good, or no, that was bad. And our source of evaluation is usually good or bad, depending on what it means to me, to each one of us, whether it benefited us momentarily or whether it was a momentary setback in life. We go through each day, each week, with bumps in the road and with smooth and safe traveling. But in every day, beyond what we see and immediately experience, there is your goodness, which exceeds all the goods and bads that we direct our attention to so much. When I'm well rested, I say, oh, I feel good. When I'm not, I say, I feel bad. Because it's all about what it means to me. It's momentary. But in the grand scope of my life, I can look back and say, on days when I felt good and on days when I felt bad, God was good all the time, in every day, providing what I need. I would imagine that many of the people here, if they take a step back from their lives, would agree that the same goes for themselves. You have shown yourself faithful in so many ways, and we come today to worship you. There are some bads going on in the world today that are causing harm to other people, and we pray that those who are committing those acts of harm would see the folly of their ways and repent and come back into your purposes and your will. There are also people throughout the world who selflessly give of themselves to others to benefit not themselves, but the other person. For those people, we give you thanks. We know that you are at work in them, for you are love, and love comes from you and goes through us, whether we know it or not, because you are active in your creation. We pray that good will come to the people we have concerns about. We rejoice that some goods have come to people we know. And so, with people in our hearts, in our minds, with concern for them and their welfare, we bring before you these people now by name, presenting them into your goodness. Hear the names now.
Laura and family.
Tracy and Kelly,
Jane, Patty, David,
Bill and Dennis,
Scarlett,
Dennis,
Tori and Mike,
Johnny,
my brother Paul, Dave, and Mom,
Chris,
Helena,
Denise,
John,
Linda and Daddy,
and Tom.
Now bring our voices together as one, Lord, as we pray as Jesus taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Let's stand.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, preachers, hear me low. Praise God.
in so many ways. And you are good in every way. These gifts that we bring to you express our appreciation and gratitude and our dependence on your goodness week after week. These gifts also represent our sincere desire that the ministry of this church continue beyond this Sunday into many Sundays ahead. So give us the wisdom and unity and cooperation to work with each other to use these resources wisely for your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. The sermon passage for today comes from the 20th chapter of the book of Matthew. Jesus is speaking to his disciples. Hear the word of the Lord. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard to work. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in that same marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. Then he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock. And he did the same with other people. And at 5 o'clock, he went out and found others still standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and going then to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received a denarius. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received a denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day in the scorching heat." But the landowner replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? That what belongs to you, take and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" You'll see a little footnote there if you're following along in your Bible. And the footnote is the literal Greek, which reads, "Is your eye evil because I am good?" And so the last will be first, and the first will be last. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, how about us? Is our eye evil because God is good? Each of those laborers got the same wage at the end of the day, whether they started early or whether they started late. They all ended at the same time, and the early expected to receive more. They were the first. They should be first. The last should come last. But they were not happy about this. And so Jesus tells the story about how good God is. That basically God has only one good to give us. Everyone. And that is who God is, God's self. Someone once says, God doesn't keep change. When God gives all of God's self. Remember that Willie Nelson song? All of me, Why not take all of me? When God gives all of God to all people. There is no change. Now, there are lesser goods than God's good. As I said, I think during the prayer, when I'm well rested, I say I feel good. When I'm not, I feel bad. But that's a momentary, temporary state of being that can change with a good night's sleep. We human beings tend to be so focused on these immediate good things that we forget that there is a greater good that God makes available to us. And that is God's self. That is God being with us in all things, in us in all things, through us in all things. And that is the blessing. And that is worth more than earthly goods. C.S. Lewis once said, if nothing in this world completely satisfies you, that means you were created for another world. If you go about trying to acquire, and at the end of acquiring more wealth and more so-called goods, you find on some particular day that you are dissatisfied, that's a way of God telling you that none of the things of this world are ultimately good. That your good must come from something beyond the immediate. And that is God with us in all things. And when God gives all of God to us. We don't necessarily receive it or accept it because we don't understand the goodness of God. And to fully trust and commit ourselves and avail ourselves and abandon our desires for God's desires, we discover something really good. God does not give change. God gives all of God's self. Or as the British say, God gives the full Montgomery breakfast. Eggs, bacon, toast, and everything else. The whole kit and caboodle. God gives God's self. Because God is not partial. God is complete. The workers in the vineyard expected God to be partial according to how long they had worked. But God is impartial because God is full and complete and God gives all of God's self. That's the message from the parable today. It is a gift. It is entirely good news. Are you willing to accept it? Chances are, you'd rather have the good thing that you think will bring you happiness. And you haven't learned yet, as many of us, and I often forget myself, that that one good thing that we set our hearts on is not our final desire. The parable of when the merchant who was in search of fine pearls finds one of great value, and what does he do? He sells everything he has to buy just that one. Because that is the complete package. That is the full Montgomery breakfast. That's the whole thing. And it is the kingdom of heaven in each one of us. That's what brings us happiness and joy. You know, happiness is a temporary experience. Joy is this permanent grip that we have on something higher than ourselves. I can be happy. Sigmund Freud said, happiness is nothing more than a temporary, momentary improvement in our circumstances. And he says, for example, if someone's been pounding their thumb with a hammer and they stop, they will be happy. Because it is a momentary thing. But joy is this enduring experience we have when we are above the ordinary. Because we're in the grasp of God. And we know we're in a good place. That's what matters. How easily we forget this. The other day when I was driving up to Worcester, I started thinking about this. How easy it is to become egocentric and think that I'm entitled and more deserving than other people. And as I was driving, I was thinking, I wonder how many different churches I have passed from my drive from New Bedford to Worcester this day. I have to believe in each one of these little hamlets and villages and towns in Massachusetts. There are 4, 5, 6 churches. You add them up in that long drive, and you've probably got hundreds of churches with hundreds of pastors representing thousands of people. And you know what? Each one of those churches thinks that somehow they're more deserving than other churches. And the pastors think that they're closer to God than others. That God and they have a particular relationship that differs from others. And so therefore they're more entitled to receive. As sometimes I may foolishly find myself thinking that somehow I'm more entitled, that God should be partial toward me. And then I said, Doug, you're just one of many. Each one of you trying to do what you need to do to keep that congregation that you are leading together. And you think somehow that your congregation is special, and God should be blessing each congregation in ways that maybe other congregations don't receive. One of the things that we need to realize in life at some particular time is we're really, truly no more special to God than anyone else. Because each one of us is fully special to God. There is no partiality. And the sermon and the text for today is telling us that. And then I thought to myself this question. What makes me more deserving than others? The only answer I could honestly come up with was, because it's me. What makes you more special than someone else? Because it's you, right? But we need to understand that God gives all of God's self to all people, and there is no reservation, hesitation, or partiality with God. All of God is what we receive, and that is the wonderful good news. When I was a kid, one of the family table prayers before meals, God is great, God is good, let us thank God for our food. By God's hand, we all are fed. Give us, Lord, this, our daily bread. I got to thinking, you know, I used to think it was solely about the food that I'm about to eat. But the prayer starts with a statement that says it all. God is great and God is good. And from the greatness and goodness of God, all blessings flow, as we just sang a few minutes ago. For God is not partial, God is complete. It's a good reminder for us to chew on, that there is a superior good that goes beyond all of these temporary things, and it's the goodness of God which is eternal, which is lasting, which is unconditional and impartial, and I'm so glad for that, because there are some days when I may make it hard for people to love me, but God still loves me nevertheless. God is not partial. God is complete. And that's the good news. The bad news in all of this is the envy part. The evil eye, because God is good. And all of us, to some extent, participate in human nature, and we succumb to the temptation of envy or begrudging another person a good that they might receive. Envy, the early Christian theologians say, may be the first and foremost and worst of all the sins. Because envy basically doesn't create anything in and of itself. It simply tries to feed off what has been created and what is good. It is a complete evil because envy produces no good. It only tries to begrudge, besmirch, and grumble about good that another person gets. And one of the things that also happens with us is not only are we envious because someone else has something we don't have, and we begrudge the great giver of all things, sometimes we take perverse pleasure in the misfortune of others. Our eye is evil, and God is always good. I've learned at my ripe old age that just because you get what you want doesn't mean everything from that point is going to be peachy keen. I'm not a betting man, but I'd wager some money that if a Democrat is sitting and saying, if all the Republicans in the world were wiped off the face of the earth, then everything would be just fine for me. And I would always get my way. And I would say it's but a matter of time before all the people who are still present, all supposedly Democrat, start to envy each other, pick at each other, begrudge each other, and are bitter toward each other in some way, and sooner or later, factions are going to form. Reverse that and say a Republican says if all the Democrats in the world were off the face of the earth, everything would then be fine. Yeah, right. It's but a matter of time before people will choose sides, pick at each other, begrudge each other, and be envious. Human nature is human nature. And part of human nature is to envy, to begrudge the goodness that another person receives from God, or to take pleasure in another person's misfortune. Our eyes are evil, but the good news is God is always good. And that is where our hope comes from. Good, the good that is God. Our passage for today comes on the heels of a previous passage from Matthew 19, where a young rich man came to Jesus and said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit life?" And Jesus says, "Why do you call me good? Only God is good." Jesus kind of saw through this. And Jesus knew that this man didn't necessarily know that Jesus was, as we now call, the Son of God. But he figured this guy's got some kind of an angle. But he says the right thing. Jesus, God's the only one that's good. And so Jesus said, "Well, if you want to inherit life, follow the commandments." And the guy says, "Well, I'm doing that pretty much." And Jesus says, "Well, if you want to be perfect, if you want to experience true good, shall we say, the good that is God, sell all your possessions, give the money to the poor, and come and follow me." And the man went away sad because he didn't want to do that. Because all of those things that he was asked to sell were the good things that constituted his life, that he thought were his ultimate good. And Jesus says there's a higher good than those things. And that is the kingdom of God. And that is God's presence with us. And he went away sad. And Jesus said to his disciples who wondered, "Well, if this guy can't make it, who can?" Jesus said, "Well, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to inherit the kingdom of heaven." They said, "Who can be saved?" Jesus said, "With humans, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible." Peter said, "Lord, we are the people who have left all those things to follow you. What will we receive?" Jesus says, "You will receive the kingdom of heaven. You will receive God, God's self. God will be all in all. You will be participants in the divine nature that is God. Your mortal flesh will be turned and transformed into a glorious body. You will participate in God's dominion. Not all these things." Not things, but God. There's a difference between good things at our level and the good things that are at God's level. When I was in New Bedford, I was the president of an organization that did daily breakfasts for homeless and poor people in the neighborhood. We would get anywhere between 50 to 100 every single morning to receive a breakfast. It was a nonprofit. It was a ministry to try to provide food for people who needed food who might otherwise not get it. And they got this nice meal. But the thing that I always recognized about them is they knew that that full tummy was only going to last until lunchtime. It was a good breakfast. We were doing a good thing for them, but it was a temporary thing, and they knew it, but they would come back the next day. But there was always one point during the breakfast, usually the prayer, the grace that we would say before everyone would eat, and I would say this: "God is good," and they would respond at the top of their lungs, "All the time," and I would say, "All the time, God is good." And I am convinced that for many of them, yes, they went away with a full tummy, but one of the things they also went away with was this joy of understanding that even though they were homeless, they were deprived, they did not have a lot of good things, they knew that there was something ultimately eternally good, and that is God. And they loved that. And if for some reason I forgot, which I sometimes forget things, to say God is good, and they respond all the time, somebody would say, hey, wait a minute. We can't eat yet. You haven't said God is good. Because that's what, as much as the food, they came for. A good greater than little goods things. Do you understand? So let's try. Let's see if you have the same kind of joy they have. You have a lot more things than any of them have. All these good things. Let's see if you can do it with some sense of joy. God is good.
All the time?
All the time.
Not bad. You understand there's something greater than just at the surface level. The joy that endures rather than temporary happiness. There's an old Swedish hymn that was my mother's favorite. And it was sung at her funeral long ago. That speaks about the difference between our earthly daily experience of good and not so good to a greater good than this. It's titled, Thanks to God for My Redeemer. And it reads like this. Thanks to God for my Redeemer. Thanks for all thou dost provide. Thanks for times now but a memory. Thanks for Jesus by my side. Thanks for pleasant, balmy springtime. Thanks for dark and dreary fall. Thanks for tears by now forgotten. Thanks for peace within my soul. Thanks for prayers that thou hast answered. Thanks for what thou dost deny. Thanks for storms that I have weathered. Thanks for all thou dost supply. Thanks for pain. And thanks for pleasure. Thanks for comfort in despair. Thanks for grace that none can measure. Thanks for love beyond compare. And here's one of the most people's favorite lines. Thanks for roses by the wayside. And thanks for thorns their stems contain. Roses and the thorns. The good and the not so good. Thanks for it all. Thanks for home and thanks for fireside. Thanks for hope, that sweet refrain. Thanks for joy and thanks for sorrow. Thanks for heavenly peace with thee. Thanks for hope in the tomorrow. Thanks through all eternity. That is as profound an expression of a greater good than the temporary, momentary, daily things that we call good and not so good. I think at some point the stewardship committee is going to ask you to talk about your blessings. And I hope I'm not stealing Karen Allen's thunder.
No.
She's very forgiving, so she'll let me pass. What are your blessings? And I'm sure that most of us would immediately think about, well, I like my car, I like my new carpet, I like all these things. What we're talking about here is something above that, greater than that. That is the enduring joy that comes from a God who gives all of God's self to us. And in every day, whatever our experiences may be of good and not so good, God is with us to shape us to become better people and maybe reach to some degree the goodness that is God. There's a higher level, is what I'm trying to say. It's the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. That is the good. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, maybe you've heard about him. He was a Russian dissident who was thrown into the gulags of the old Soviet Union for a long time for doing a relatively minor crime, which was opposing the communist regime at the time. So they locked him up and sent him to the gulags in Siberia. And during that time there, in a situation none of us would want to endure for as much as a morning, let alone year after year, At the end of it, when it was time for him to leave, he said, "Bless you, Gulag. Bless you for being in my life. For there, for here in this gulag, lying upon the rotting prison straw, I came to realize that the object of life is not prosperity, as we are made to believe, but the maturity of the human soul." He left a vastly different person than he was when he entered. And it was because the good of God was with him, even in what would otherwise be very bad circumstances. There is a higher good, is what I'm trying to say. Higher good than all the things that we direct our attention to. And it comes to us by faith. And faith comes to us by the gift from God of the Holy Spirit, who works in us to generate the faith that in our own human frailty and mortality, we can't always muster up. As the woman said, "Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief. Send the Spirit to give me this kind of faith and confidence in even the not-so-good things, that good things can still come from this," as it did for Solzhenitsyn in the gulag. St. Teresa of Avila, one of the great mystics of the Christian faith throughout history, was the first one to say something to the effect, "More tears are shed over answered prayers than unanswered prayers." Why is that the case? Because usually what we pray for are little good things that will only temporarily satisfy us. And when we get those little temporary things and we believe our prayers have been answered, it's only a matter of time before we realize that it wasn't really our ultimate good. Remember that Garth Brooks song? Anybody here a country and western? Okay, we got a few. God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. All right, Elaine knows that. Garth Brooks talking about going to a high school football game. He saw his old high school flame there. And he was thinking about the days when he was a young man and he would pray to God that God would make that girl his own for all time. And they eventually broke up. And he found a new love, a wonderful wife that he was so thankful for. And he realized that all of his praying for the old high school flame would have been just a flash in the pan. That what he really got when God didn't answer that prayer was something far greater. And that's what it's understanding when we understand that this is about the faith and the goodness of God. That God gives only one wage, and that's all of God. And not to begrudge other people like those guys did in the vineyard that day. Thanks be to God for unanswered prayers. You know, I have to say, I have to thank Greendale People's Church and my time here with you, because it's been a great growing experience for me to serve you as pastor of a non-denominational church. For almost 30 years, I served in denominations. And in denominations, usually most of what they try to do is to motivate the pastors to produce ministries that provide these temporary little good things. Maybe a little more money to denominational headquarters. Maybe a little bit more esteem and prestige for the denomination in the eyes of the public. And most of the ways that the pastors are motivated is, what are you doing for the denomination? How are you making us look better? How are you bringing a little bit more money to us? And now I'm free from that. And it's no longer serving a denomination. It's about serving God. And what a wonderful thing it is.
Amen.
I'm not getting any prestige, but you know what? I'm getting all of God. And God is good all the time.
All the time.
Darn right. God is good all the time. Thank you that I can serve here. And this can be about God and not about all those little daily things. I remember in the denomination that I served, one time there was this guy I went to seminary with, and they produced this really cool video about his ministry down in Atlanta. about how he was doing all of these great things and the church was going gangbusters and it was all glorious because it's a part of that denomination. Ta-da! I saw him in a ministerial meeting say, wow, I really like that video they did of your church. Things must really be good. He looked at me and said, Doug, don't believe everything you see. It really isn't so good. But you know, when you get in organizations, the organizations want to pump up themselves, and the way to pump up yourself is to show the public that you have all of these little good things. You know what? There's something far greater than any of that, and that is the work of God in and through us. And I'm experiencing that here. I remember there was one time when I was at a ministerial meeting, and the pastor who was speaking, who was the speaker of that particular event, he said, after this lecture today, I have a number of books that are yours to keep for free. Just recently, I received a telephone call from the publisher of the book that I wrote about 15 years ago. And the publisher said, we were cleaning out our warehouse. And in the corner of the warehouse, buried under a lot of dust and dirt, were three boxes of your old books. None of which had sold us, and no copy had been sold in 15 years. And he was laughing and saying he remembers how excited he was when he was going to be published, and he was going to be seen and read by people, and he was going to have prestige. And now 15 years later, he's got to give away his books so that dust can fall on some other books in that warehouse. And I realized there's a greater good than all of this. There's a greater good than all of the things that you think are going to bring you happiness. They might give you temporary happiness, but it's not joy. Joy is giving God thanks for the roses by the wayside and for the thorns that their stems contain. Because in all of those things, God is good. And God will see us through. And God will make us better people at the end.
Amen.
God is good all the time. One last time. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
That's the answer.
Right.
Amen.
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 Thank you.
when Jesus would be at table for meals, he would often gather those that others despised, the sinners, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, etc. And there was something wonderful about being in communion, being in fellowship with Jesus. The old understanding was, you don't want to be around bad people because they might pollute you and make you bad. The thing about Jesus is, he's only good. Good all the time. He is not polluted by our not-so-goodness. Rather, being in communion and fellowship with him makes us better people. We become good in communion with Jesus as we come to the table today. It's not about how good you are, but about how good God is. It's not about whether we're worthy. It's about the acceptance and the call that Jesus gives us to come to the table to receive this fellowship and this communion with him. So the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray. Lord, come among us this day by the Spirit and in your power. Meet us where we are, as we are, who we are. And bring with you your goodness to us. A goodness that outlasts the temporary good things that we strive after. A goodness that overshadows and overrides the bad things. And grows us more in grace as you see us through and as we are in fellowship with you during the difficult times. In all things, you are good. You are at work in all things, bringing them to good. For we who love you, who are called according to your purposes. Through this communion today, speak to us of your forgiveness for our past failures, of your acceptance of us in spite of our unacceptable aspects, for your grace that overshadows anything that we think forbids relationship with you. You come to us, and for that we give you thanks. You are in our lives, and we give you thanks. Now come in us and through us as we receive these elements today. Bless them to communicate your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The bread which we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. The cup which we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? We have gifts from God for us, the people of God. Receive them today with grateful hearts. Taking your bread, this is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. Take and eat. And with the cup. This cup is the new covenant in the blood of Christ. Drink of it, all of you. Let's pray. Lord, you are good. You are good all the time. We pray that that would echo in our minds and hearts throughout this week when we go through tough times and good. That above all of that and beneath it and all around it, you are good to us. You have fed us spiritual food in the sacrament of the body and blood of your Son Jesus, who makes us new and gives us life eternal. You've served us. Now we pledge to serve you and the world around us. announcements for this week. We continue the course that I'm teaching on Wednesdays. It's going to be at 10 a.m. You can hop on board this week. If you missed last week, no harm, no foul. Start this week. It'll be fun. Please come if you're able at 10 a.m. I think Carolina sets up your opportunity for people to watch it online if you're not able to come in person. The back-to-school pizza party. Now, I understand Marion said we're not getting sign-ups.
It's on the, she made one today. It's on the coffee table.
Okay, it's on the coffee table. So we're having a great time doing this. It's low stress. It's all fun. It's good pizza. It's good company. It just takes a short amount of time. And for goodness sake, you're probably going to eat lunch that day anyhow. Why not come here and have it with other people? It's a lot of fun. It'll take place this Wednesday at noon. The pizza party, back to school will be the theme. So if you plan to come, think about those school days and some of your experiences. We'd love to hear about what life was like for you as a young man or woman going to school. It's a great time to come together. Sign-up sheet is in Fisher Hall. Sandwiches for All Saints Church. Anybody want to make that announcement or give specifics? Go ahead, Janet.
This Thursday, we start back making the sandwiches for the cafe that they have downtown at All Saints Church. If anybody wants to help, come and join us at 10:30. We bagged 40 lunches, and then we drop them off at All Saints Church.
Very good. Thank you. We're going to try to keep the community warm by donating winter clothes. In Fisher Hall, a drop-off station will be available for you to drop off your donations of new or gently used winter hats and gloves or new white socks. Anybody who's responsible for this want to add to it? Go ahead, Lynn.
It's kind of an add-on to the breakfast program. And there's a three-part hamper that's in Fisher Hall right now. Just as you walk in, sitting on a chair. So, ready to be loaded up.
All right. The altar flowers, I was looking at this during the week because Carolina sends it to me so I can look it over before I stumble through it anyhow on Sunday morning. And I really wish Estelle and Diane were named Smith and Jones. Because I was trying to pronounce their last names and found myself at a little bit of a loss. So there. Okay. Marge Clark loves Estelle and
Diane
and wanted to donate flowers in their memory. What a nice thought. What a nice gesture. We're grateful for that. And peace be to their memories. Michelle and Dennis are providing coffee hour today. They've already gone from our place right now to Fisher Hall to prepare. Hope to see you there. Any other announcements? All right. Let's then get together and gather and sing with all we have, number 695, as we gather at the table.
Our hearts
benediction from the choir.